evening, Urban Today. Welcome to this special edition of The Checkpoint. My name is Nicholas Wasaja. We hope out there you're sanitizing, we hope you're social distancing, and you're wearing your mask, because COVID-19 is real and it is still ravaging our society. Now, did you know that environmental pollution can cost you a buck? The urge to maximize profit today can be lessened by unreparable damage on Mother Earth. Now, to discuss this are two distinguished gentlemen, the Italian ambassador to Uganda, His Excellency Salongo Massimiliano Masanti, and the German ambassador to Uganda, Matthias Schaar. Gentlemen, welcome to the show.
So I'm Massimiliano Masanti, Salongo ambassador of Italy to Uganda. It's roughly 2 years that I'm in Uganda. In October it will be 2 years. Uganda is part of Africa, and Africa, to be fair, accounts only for 3% of the overall pollution in terms of effects of climate change. But it will be most probably the most affected continent by climate change itself. This is why there must be a drive, a will, a political will, for each African country, Uganda included, to be part in the greatest framework of the Paris Agreement for the implementation, as you know, of the maximum limit of 1.5 degrees Celsius as a point of reference for future generations and for the due protection of environment as we with the objectives we set before. As you were rightly remembering UNFCCC before, but of course the Paris Agreement is a milestone and sets the bar pretty high. So if we don't commit ourselves immediately for this 1.5%, which means today, tomorrow, it will be hardly achieved and actually respected. I'm sure you heard also the alarms from the United Nations Secretary General on this specific point, recalling the necessity of keeping a transparent approach to the whole commitments which countries, African countries included, Uganda included, have committed for within the Paris Agreement. I must say that most recently the Ministry of Water and Environment, which has a drive towards climate change fight and the containment actually of the increase of pollution at the world level. You are part. Let me say, by the way, that you have specific persons which were on the other part of the barricade before, like my friend, the State Minister Beatrice Aniwar. She is very much aware of the challenges that Uganda is facing in terms of environment and climate change and the effects of climate change on the whole country. Most recently, you've been accredited to do two very important funds. The Green Climate Fund, which is funded by all European partners. Italy participates only the Climate Fund, actually Green Climate Fund, with 350 million euros, which represent resources totally dedicated to African countries also to fight climate change and to meet, of course, the objectives which have been set within international agreements, especially the Paris Agreement, and the Adaptation Fund. I must say that since 2015, you defined very clearly which were your nationally determined contributions, which is more or less the levels of and the objectives that you, the tasks that you have, and final goals that you have set for yourself as a country. Of course, accountability is pretty much important. We will be following closely with you, especially now that Italy is COP26 with UK, COP26 co-chair, and we hold at the same time G20 presidency. And climate change has been set, and Africa is at the center of it. We invited the three African countries, actually, apart from Algeria, of course, as G20. We invited the DRC, and of course Rwanda. Rwanda because he is the chair of NEPAD, the temporary chair of NEPAD. So the focus is on Africa, the focus is on the Paris Agreement, but mainly we want finally countries, people to be governors, to be accountable in terms of transparency, in terms of meeting the goals that they set by themselves with the nationally determined contributions. This is overall for a general framework in terms of international commitment. As you know, on a closer look as an ambassador to Uganda, much has to be done still. There are many threats. You know, climate change is part of it. And as I was saying, you participate only to 3% of the overall pollution in the world and to the climate change effects. But you are susceptible actually to be really hard eaten by climate change, because African countries and Eastern African countries in particular are basically, the economy is based on agriculture. So the fluctuations and the movements of climate change have a strong impact on your capacity of keeping up in terms of production, in terms of modernization, in terms of sustainability with a growing population. It is very much important to have an overall perspective in terms of climate change and environmental protection. And wildlife protection and the protection of your forests is certainly part of it. So if climate change is going to produce effects on your soil, it is undoubted that policies and the lack of commitment and transparency in terms of protection of wildlife species and forests in particular, and I'm talking about Bugoma, Dzoka and others, the Buindi forest itself with this richness in terms of wildlife, gorillas and many others. If you don't commit yourself now to this, in 30, 40 years, half of your capacity of in terms of sustainability to face and counter climate change will be compromised. We need really to act now. So policies, water sanitation and water security is part of it, because of course with increase in terms of temperatures, we are facing a shortage of water, and this is causing also difficulties in terms of dams among countries, as you've seen a little bit more in the area, in Eastern Africa, but much more in the Horn of Africa. So we are facing challenges which are undoubtedly a product produced by climate change, but we are still contributing to, unfortunately, not to support the environment in a way to ensure its conservation in a longer time, not for ourselves, not for us here present today, but for generations to come, and certainly for our sons and daughters. I think the political will is increasingly, awareness is being increasingly supported, both by population, and of course by governors and politicians, because they begin to see the effects of climate change on everyday life, on food sustainability and security, on water. And this effect, which has been unfortunately, of course, strengthened by this negative effect, which has been strengthened by the pandemic, is producing effects that have to be countered today. I believe awareness is there. I believe that sometimes it's very difficult to find the right balance between development and conservation. And that's one of the issues we've been discussing many times with the German ambassador and at the EU level. And what is the right recipe to ensure that a country develops like it has to be? And there are still margins of developments, as you've seen, from an industrial point of view, from an agricultural point of view, and at the same time ensuring the conservation that preserves your treasures, your forest, your agriculture, and your population, making the whole system, the whole ecosystem, sustainable in time. It's a difficult recipe, but I think it's our task to, as European Union, to support Uganda in this effort, in identifying possibly the priorities, but also of course Ugandan politicians and of Ugandan governors to identify the right recipe, taking into consideration that whatever they will be doing now will officiate or will support instead future generations. So it's not for them, it's for the future generations. And you know very well that projections say that in a few decades, the population of Uganda might be 100 million people. So sustainability is at stake. Climate change is part of the whole mechanism, but we need, and I wish to strengthen once again this message to, of course, to our friends at the presidency and our friends at the ministries, that we have all together to act now. It's a very good question. Actually, the first, it's a multiple challenges situation, which is polyhedric. It's very difficult to give a sharp answer. But I can tell you that actually you're facing a threat like there was no before, because this strange conjunction between pandemic and climate change is affecting everyday life for all of us. It certainly affects our soil, it certainly affects our economies and population, our people. I think the time has come to make choices. There are things in terms of development that you can make, and I think to some transitions in terms of liquefied gas instead of logging and using your natural forest to burn woods directly or to produce charcoal that is highly polluting, for example. Of course, there must be a trade-off. We are still in the transition through carbon fossil fuels. So eventually, we still have need, we are in need of using as resources a little bit of carbon, a little bit of logging, but it's in terms of dimension of the phenomenon. We cannot touch certainly your lungs. It's the same for us, for human beings. If you touch lungs, is going to be compromised your own health. Look at the pandemic. What does COVID does mainly? Affects your lungs. So climate change is the same. It's a pandemic for nature. And our actions are actually very important. We decide exactly how will be our future. We have to preserve Bugoma. We have to preserve Dzoka. There's no business in our view, I know the German ambassador agrees on this, there's no true trade-off in this. Business is not justified if you affect the lungs of your ecosystem in Uganda. And the marching unfolds then. Is that really necessary? Because you have an overproduction. Of course you have problems in terms still of distribution of electricity. And electricity is very important in terms of development, especially if you want to develop an industrial, I have an industrial hedge, stronger than before. But apart from distribution, you have an overproduction of electricity. Problem remains distribution. Do we need a dam that will affect the margins on faults, which is something that is the strongest actually natural faults in the world, in terms of strength and volume of water. Tourism is very important for Uganda. It accounts for 7% of your GDP, 7% of your overall employment. So it's important not to diminish the role of tourism, which is directly interlinked, of course, with nature. Tourists, and even as domestic tourists in Uganda, we come to see your treasures and your animals. We don't come to see just, you know, the overall landscape. We want to see. You have to preserve those treasures. In terms of national contribution, Italy, yes. Very good. Yeah. No, we are of course actively present. You mentioned very clearly one example of, let's say, mitigation of climate change. This is a very good mix-up in reality, because the Mount Moroto Biosphere Reserve project with UNESCO that we are conducting with the UNDP and the University of Padua in Italy, and the Diocese of Moroto is an example of a sort of a model of good preservation. Because you have many elements all together. You have a community that has been threatened in its cultural identity, and in his own dimension, and maybe dislocated just because business might be jumping in, like it happened with the, unfortunately, sugar production in Bugoma. We have an incredible national forest, which we hope, with the help of the Minister for Karamoja in cabinet, we might be transforming into national park, so with a stronger protection in terms of identity and in terms of value. We have specific species of animals which are only there, like dromedaries. Can you imagine? Like camels. They're moving, strolling freely. I wouldn't imagine in Uganda to see something like that, but you can see in Mount Moroto. And then, of course, other specific species, animal, plants, flowers. What was the idea? I might say this was top up, an example, a model for Africa that has to be followed by all means of top up. The Diocese of Moroto identified a problem. And he said, how, in this case, my friend, the Bishop Damiano Guzzetti, the Bishop of Moroto, he said, how can we tackle, put together these problems and try to find a unique solution? And the biosphere reserves, there is in UNESCO a new generation of biosphere reserves. Before, in Africa, we have different ones. But the first generation now of UNESCO-certified sites as biosphere reserves are the new ones. And Moroto will be the first one to be proposed at African level. It will be the first model in Africa. If he succeeds, and I think that roughly in 1.5 years, 2 years, he will be there. Now we finished all the feasibility studies. There was the official launch also with the Ugandan authorities. Now we are in the phase of proposing the model and the candidature, of course, at UNESCO level with all the due forms. And in roughly 1.5 years, 2 years, we are sure, we are convinced that Moroto will be the first biosphere reserves in the country. This is, again, a very good example of the model. With limited resources, you can make of a fantastic but simple national forest a site of world interest, which will be permanently protected by international organizations in the world, UN, UNDP, Italy, Europe. So that's just a small example. As Italy, we operate in many different fields, normally in the north and in Karamoja, where we entered in the country 111 years ago, in 1910, with the Combonian Fathers. So we started education, water sanitation, and mainly health. We are still very much on health, which, as you know, depends. It's a side effect also of climate change and the effects of environmental challenges on people, because of course with the diminishing crops because of climate change, with the diminishing protection of cultures and the cultivations, of course we have to face increasing challenges. We are now financing Karamoja development infrastructure for health with 10 million euros as Italy. But water sanitation we never cease to do. The biosphere reserves was our sheer idea. And we'll continue, of course, to support local authorities and the government and the presidency, possibly to protect its treasures. We've been fighting together with the German ambassador and other EU ambassadors to preserve Bugoma, Buindi, Zocca, that is logging, it's going at an increasing pace, unfortunately. And we are opposing sometimes projects which seems to be of infrastructural development, not because we are against, but because we believe we want to help Uganda and identify the right projects without doing the ones which necessarily will affect in terms of percentage, will have a huge impact on the environment once again. We want to avoid, to create a condition, a point of no return with our Ugandan friends. And let me say that we want to do this because we made our mistakes before. As Europeans, as Westerners, in older times, we didn't pay much of attention at much older times. But we then created, we grew with the awareness. Our youth actually are very much committed on climate protection and on fighting climate change. And nowadays they ask us, their fathers, grandfathers, to look at them and to say, ensure that we will have a future beyond your lives for future generations. And that's exactly what we're trying to do. You know, it was a funny anecdote, actually, because while she was bringing it to the cabinet, Beatriz Aniwar, she was sending messages to us, to me also, we are very good friends, and she was telling me, you know, we're presenting, we're almost there, it's passing. I believe that the law contains all the elements touching all the possibilities to create the right framework in terms of legislation, in terms of enforcement, in terms of transparency and following what the law will be, of course, imposing. Of course, it's like a big contenitor for now. We need to fill up that contenitor. But for the first time, and I appreciate very much the government for this, because it's a milestone from this point of view, you created the right contenitor where you can put the laws and implement and make enforcement and have people respect the laws, business respect the laws, and possibly ensure transparency in terms of accountability. And it's all in the law. It has, of course, to be filled up with contents. But I believe that actually the framework has been rightly prepared. I'm very happy about that law, I must say. It has, I repeat, political will at this point is everything. The legislation will have to do even more. But I really much appreciate it.
EU delegation visit to East Western Uganda and Northern Uganda. Partly you mentioned the key issues in their Goma action. Of course, Zoka. We tend to see politically motivated degazettement of these protected areas when they shouldn't even go. We still believe there's a lot of land outside these protected areas which can be used for growing sugarcane. Isn't this kind of something which goes against sustainable principles for which you are working and which partly addresses the issue of climate change, biodiversity conservation, and then of course the preservation of the landscape that is supposed to be part of the water catchment areas?
Yes.
And we believe you've been engaging the politicians, including the chief politician in this country. Well, what is it that is going on from your visit? What did you see? What do you appreciate? Should we give up and say probably those ones have to go for the sake of development, but there are concessions we can get and keep for others? What are you seeing at the end of the pipeline?
I had the opportunity to touch these few of these issues before, when we were talking about, of course, what Uganda could be doing more, but most possibly. It's a little bit of a test bench for Uganda, because it's the test bench of true political will. We met the president in November last year. Last time we had quite a conversation also with my friend, the German ambassador, with the president on conservation, and specifically on Bugoma, Dzoka, Murchison Falls. And we asked his intervention. And I must say the outcome and the response was very direct. A little bit more general on Murchison, and we hope it will, anyway, we will continue to create sensitivity and awareness also on that, but very decided on Bugoma and Dzoka. No, these are forests that have not to be touched by business, by people, because are ours, we have to preserve. It was very clear, His Excellency the President. Problem is that, of course, is top down, so you have to go from Mr. President, down through all the different stages. And there's always in between in the stages different influences that can determine the outcome, the final outcome of the instructions, which come from politics and from, of course, the Mr. President. So, problem in the case of Bugoma is that when you get down exactly to the Bugoma forest, business is huge. It's another, by the way, example of overproduction, which is not needed, because you have other source of production of sugar, and you already export your overproduction without having Hoima sugar necessarily on Bugoma. You already do this in other parts of the country in terms of production. So when it's about overproduction, there's no need to create a clash between the preservation and conservation of an important forest like Bugoma, and in perspective, the necessity of ensuring development. Of course, people say, yes, but some of us work at the Oima Sugar. True, but how many of you? And what will be the outcome once the forest will not be there? In terms of tourism, in terms, you know, that the tourism is from this point of view, is the natural reflection of having such a fantastic patrimony like your forests. With tourism, you not only create awareness and appreciation for your treasures, for your pearls, talking about the Pearl of Africa, but you create a drive towards preservation of the same. And the problem in this case is that I don't see any natural nice trade-off between reducing Bugoma, and we've seen also images from satellites, notwithstanding the efforts, even at the presidential level, they're still eroding slowly the forest. Some is from logging of poor people that they need, in difficult times, as you were saying, and that's sometimes the challenge, is the same in Dzoka with refugees. It's difficult sometimes to determine who shouldn't use the logging for using fires, which are of course necessary. But then you know very well that the business jumps in, and the dimension of that goes well beyond the necessity of the local communities. So the recipe is very difficult to find, I know that, to identify. But if we don't, make clear statements and clear commitments well beyond a general assessment that those forests must be untouched, and I say that awareness is increasing every day more from this point of view. So we praise, of course, Uganda for this, but we ask Uganda to make a further effort in terms of conservation for Bugoma, Dzoka, and other realities. And we ask once again, because we have no direct interest. We don't produce sugar. We don't log. We don't produce charcoal. We are just asking our friends of Uganda to avoid making mistakes they would regret in future generations, because we come from that experience, and we want friends like our African friends, Africa in general, and Uganda in particular, to learn from our own mistakes and avoid to make their own mistakes from this point of view that we might be regretting in time. We felt the need, actually, with the pre-COPs, on the necessity in reality, knowing that the challenges ahead are tough, and that sometimes we are aligned, but disaligned on a few of the issues, including the 1.5 degrees Celsius that we should be respecting, and on which, as I said before, the Secretary General of the United Nations called upon respect, because it might be too late otherwise, not only to respect that parameter, but to respect the double of it in a few years. So we need really to act now and be aware. But the best way, of course, in view of our co-chairing and the summit that will be in Glasgow, we need to coordinate and create more awareness. That's why Pre-COPs 26 were organized. And I must say that we had the possibility of making it jointly also at G20 level to create even more. It's a sort of amplificator, a sort of a contenitor that helps us to create more awareness, not only at COP26 level, which includes practically all over the world, but the first G20, the first 20 economies of the world to engage.
We are still discussing climate change and climate resilience, but first, let's break.